Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Hear, Stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. that to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Now, when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover feast, many believed in his name when they saw the signs which he did. But Jesus did not trust himself to them, because he knew all men and needed no one to bear witness of man, for he himself knew what was in man.
The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Over the years, Father Stephen and I have led a number of pilgrimages to the eternal city of Rome, and whilst we were living in Rome at the Generalate, we were delighted to give tours for people who had come out to visit. One thing I recall in particular is taking pilgrims to see St. Peter's Basilica, and walking from the nearest metro stop that we'd always go the long way round to the Basilica. The reason being so that you could turn the corner at the end and see down the Via della Conciliazione and look at St. Peter's in all its splendid glory. Another thing that I say to anyone who asks me about visiting Rome is this: make sure to go to St. Peter's early in the morning, preferably queue up when it opens. For if you go later in the day, may well have a different experience. There have certainly been occasions where I've been in St. Peter's in the afternoon and felt rather like imitating our Lord in today's Gospel, not primarily directed at the people running the Basilica, but rather at the tourists who seem to forget that this is a church, not a Baroque theme park. Zeal for thy house will consume me.
How, though, are we to interpret our Lord's actions in the Gospel? What exactly is going on? There's an interesting detail in the Gospel of John that we've just heard that is clearer in the Greek. Our Lord makes a whip out of some cord, and in the Greek it's clear, I think, that the whip itself was not used against the money changers, but against the animals, the oxen and the pigeons and so forth. This begs the question, why were there animals there at all? Well, the animals had to be there. Animals were a necessary part of the sacrifices that God had instituted to be offered to him in the temple. The Jews were simply following God's commandments by keeping the animals in the court before they could be slaughtered and ritually sacrificed. So something else is going on in the Gospel as well. In the first reading from the book of Exodus, we have the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments formed and form the heart of morality for those who seek to do God's will. They represent God intervening in the world and in our lives so that we no longer have to search in dim light to discern good from evil, but can rely on his divine word. The Ten Commandments formed the heart of the Torah, the law of God, contained in the first five books of the Bible, also known as the Pentateuch. The Ten Commandments, along with all the other commandments that God gave, were given within the context of two key events: the Exodus from Egypt and the covenant at Mount Sinai. The Exodus from Egypt had two clear ends: land and worship. The Promised Land was, as we know, a land flowing with milk and honey. Where the lactose intolerant and diabetics were to go, I have no idea. But we often overlook Pharaoh, God's words to Pharaoh as well, given by Moses. God said, "Let my people go to serve me in the wilderness." And we must go a 3 days' journey in the wilderness and sacrifice to the Lord our God, as he commands us. Freedom from slavery meant freedom to worship God in the ways that he had desired and commanded. When the Jews reached the Promised Land, they built a temple in fulfillment of God's command. And in the temple, God's name would dwell, and there would true worship be offered to him in fulfillment of the law. Law and liturgy, Torah and temple, are ultimately one. The money changers in the temple courtyard seem to have been making a profit from this, but our Lord's action remains obscure if it's seen primarily or solely as a criticism of the money changers' profiteering. Animals do cost money, so they would need to be bought. Our Lord's action, however, in making a whip to drive out the beasts that were to be sacrificed, would have stopped the worship that was commanded by God to be given him in his temple, where his name dwelt. The prophet Zechariah states that on the day of the Lord there shall no longer be a trader in the house of the Lord of hosts. Law and liturgy, Torah and temple are one, not in the buildings or rites of the old covenant, not in the sheep and goats and the punctilious Pharisees, but one in our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ himself. The beasts are cast out of the temple because they are no longer needed. Their day is finished. Their sacrifices have come to an end, for God will provide himself as sacrifice. When our Lord is questioned about his actions, he replies by speaking of his death and resurrection.
If we understand this passage as if our Lord is solely concerned with profiteering money changers, then this doesn't make any sense at all. However, when we know that our Lord was proclaiming himself to be the fulfillment of Torah and Temple, it makes sense that he would say the Temple would be destroyed and rebuilt in 3 days, for this Temple is his body. What, though, does this mean to us here and now? As the Son of God, Jesus' fulfillment of Torah and Temple is such that all human beings are enabled to share in the grace of the Holy Spirit that flows through his actions. Through the sacraments, and particularly the representation of his sacrifice on the cross in each and every Mass, we, the baptized, are incorporated into Christ's mystical body. In Christ's mystical body, we attain true communion with God and are enabled by him to offer to God true worship. In Christ's mystical body and through his divine grace, we are transformed more and more fully into a temple of the Holy Spirit. Perhaps some of us are even basilicas. In Christ's mystical body alone can we be holy, fulfilling the Torah, and offer to the God true and fitting worship, fulfilling the temple. The only thing, dear brothers, greater than this union with God in Christ's mystical body, is heaven itself. The sacraments will be fulfilled by those in a state of glory, by that divine communion in the kingdom in which we are all firstborn sons, in which we will be part of that mystical body truly and forever, that which is the perfect temple, Holy Zion, where the zeal for God's house will have consumed us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, who was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with his riches. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
As the solemnity of Easter approaches, dear brothers, let our prayer to the Lord be all the more insistent that all of us and the whole multitude of the baptized, together with the entire world, may come to share more abundantly in this sacred mystery. that God may be pleased to increase faith and understanding in the catechumens who are to be initiated by holy baptism in the coming paschal solemnity. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
That peoples in need may find help, and that peace and security may be firmly established everywhere. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
That all who are afflicted or suffering temptation may be strengthened by his grace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
That all of us may learn to distribute the fruits of self-denial for the good of those in need. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We ask now for the intercession of our Heavenly Mother as we pray. Hail Mary,
full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Have mercy, O Lord, on the prayers of your Church, and turn with compassion to the hearts that bow before you, that those who make sharers in the divine mystery may never be left without your assistance. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and for all his holy church.
Be pleased, O Lord, with these sacrificial offerings, and grant that we who beseech your pardon for our sins may take care to forgive our neighbor. Through Christ our Lord.
Blessed Joseph, as spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs,
Peter, Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, Jude, Linus, Cletus, Ben, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that, through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation, and counted among the flock of those you have chosen, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Christ our Lord. Amen.
To us also, your servants who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share of fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Martyr, Linus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Yeah.
Your kindness grant your servants his grace, that abiding in the